The only way to describe today's character is, what else? Grumpy. But let's face it, he's only grumpy on the outside. Maybe it's a front. By the end of the film, we find out that he's paranoid, wise, kind, and caring. Who could provide such depth to a seemingly one-dimensional character? Let's find out. Pinto Colvig was born Vance DeBar Colvig in Jacksonville, Oregon. Because of his freckles, he earned the nickname Pinto, meaning spotted. As a boy, Pinto was fascinated with the circus, and specifically with clowns. He spent a few weeks in 1905 performing as a clown. He was also extremely interested in art. An excerpt from Pinto's memoir, It's a Crazy Business.
When Pinto was 13, his family moved from rural Jacksonville to the nearby railway town of Medford, where brass bands and circuses continued to perform a few times each year. For the bands, Pinto volunteered to carry banners or hold music as they performed through town. He never missed a circus performance, especially as they rekindled his memories of working alongside a clown barker in Portland. At school, he was drawn to art, particularly the type of cartooning that appeared in papers. He learned what he could in Medford as he studied the funny papers, believing he might teach himself how to draw. I thought it would be mighty nice to find myself on the 25th floor of the New York Times building wearing an artist's purple smock.
After a failed attempt at a real job at a train depot, Pinto traveled around performing in various bands and eventually ending up with his brother at Oregon Agricultural College. Although Pinto never went past the 8th grade, he was accepted as a special student.
In college, Pinto studied drawing and illustration and worked toward becoming a commercial cartoonist. Outside of his classes, he developed skills as a caricaturist and even put together his own chalk talk routine. In the early part of the 20th century, a chalk talk routine was a vaudeville act where an artist created drawings for his audience while delivering jokes or laying down a funny story. For this act, likely first delivered on campus sometime in the autumn of 1912, he billed himself as Pinto, the nightmare of caricature. According to the campus paper, Pinto created quick and amazing drawings using nothing more than, quote, mustache blacking and graphite, so he said. For 15 or 20 minutes, he captivated the audience by producing humorous drawings of professors and students. The high point of his act was the magical changing drawing. He would draw one object, such as a wine glass, and then, with a half dozen strokes, make this wine glass into a long-nosed greenhorn, new to Oregon, who was sucking down cider through a straw. Colvig is a hummer, the college paper concluded, with real ability, and this stunt will prove tremendously popular elsewhere.
He attended college for 3 years on and off, but, like most men, his infatuation with the circus got the better of him. Probably the monkeys. Monkey. Look at him.
After arranging a job at a traveling circus band, Pinto traded in his vaudeville rags for the white gloves and baggy overalls of a clown. He was officially a member of the Al G. Barnes Big Four Ring Wild Animal Circus.
After two tours working as a clown and a pinch barker, and after marrying his wife, Margaret Slavin, he made his way to San Francisco.
In 1917, he's in San Francisco making cartoons. He's a pioneer animator making advertising cartoons. This is the same era when Walt Disney is in Kansas City doing exactly the same thing, making advertising cartoons, which would be shown before the feature in movie theaters. He writes to his father, I'm drawing 10,000 pictures per day, and I've been doing advertising scenarios for the company. And in my spare time, I draw on my nightmare. So he's got side projects at home, apparently animating a project involving his horse. He says, the office is busier every day, and we will soon occupy the whole top floor, put in two more cameras. Harry Hicks wants the nightmare films when they're done. He says he has a place for me in Chicago when I learn the business. Of course, that didn't happen. And we have a picture of the studio. This is the Animated Cartoon Film Corporation, these four guys. From the left, we have Angel Espoy, who went on to a career in fine art. You can find his paintings online. Tack Knight was a very good cartoonist, had a syndicated cartoon strip called Lil Folks. And there's Pinto standing. And Byington Ford, who became a lifelong friend, is at the animation frame. And he named one of his sons Byington. And you can see what Byington Ford is holding. He's holding a paper cutout, and this is how they did their animation. Animation was still being invented in these days. And I don't know if anyone was doing cell animation, you know, celluloid, where they would draw on celluloid sheets. I haven't done that research. But this is how they did it, pretty quick and dirty process. And the camera is above Byington's head there. And in the background, through the doorway, you can see their dark room with a safe light hanging, and that big drum is what they dried the film on.
After about 2 years, Pinto became tired of animation and ended up taking a job at a newspaper, where he took movie actors out to lunch and got to know them pretty well. They began to invite him out to a little-known place called Hollywood. He began to act off and on in the San Francisco Bay Area, and in 1921, he started his own animation studio, which only lasted 1 year. In 1922, he tried his hand at a comic strip.
He syndicates this cartoon strip called Life on the Radio Wave, which runs June through October of 1922. And the premise of this was satirizing the brand new American obsession with radio, which was, you know, radio was brand new. This is before radio speakers. You know, people sat with their radio sets and headphones on, and so it was brand new. And Pinto was on the crest of this wave. And some of them are actually amusing, but the strip quickly devolved. He started following the adventures of one elderly gentleman, who makes contact with a flapper over the radio and carries on essentially, you know, an internet romance, you know, sight unseen. He's romancing this woman, and of course it goes nowhere and very quickly results in the death of the comic strip.
In 1923, he moved to the newfangled land of Hollywood, where he worked for various movie companies. For Century Comedy Productions, he worked as a gag man and actor on Buster Brown comedies. He also helped draw effects on the cells of the films. In 1928, he teamed up with Walter Lantz and helped create the character Bolivar, the squawking ostrich.
But in Pinto's book about his animation career, he describes screening this footage for Warner Brothers and doing the sound effects live. He says, Leon Schlesinger and Jack Warner seemed to get a kick out of it. I could hear them laughing, and it made me feel mighty good. Not until sometimes afterward did I learn that during the showing of the film, they'd kept their eyes on me, watching my wild antics while supplying the sounds. They'd forgotten to look at the cartoon.
In 1930, Pinto was hired by Disney as a sound man and gag man. He played in the orchestra with his clarinet and helped with making sounds during recordings. Man, this guy does everything. Clowning, cartooning, clarinetting. It's incredible.
This is a studio recording session, and this is how they did it in the building. In the beginning, they screened the cartoon and did all the sound live in one go. Quite an operation. You can see there's Walt Disney in the upper left-hand corner and the sophisticated recording equipment. The singing group in another corner. There's some of the sound effects equipment. There's a siren mounted on a bicycle wheel and a tub for thumping, or you know, a barrel for thumping, I guess. The sound effects table. Marimba, xylophone, clackers, cowbell, and other unidentifiable objects. And then in the back, there's a guy baying at a microphone hanging over him. And over in the band, there's Pinto playing his clarinet next to Walt Disney.
Pinto's first character he played for Disney was Pluto in 1931's Moose Hunt. The following year, he began performing as Goofy in Mickey's Revue in 1932.
Nice! I thought you was a fish!
Oh, yeah? Oh, yeah, you're right. Oh, yeah.
Oh, oh, oh! Oh, oh, oh!
Ah, yes, you're here.
He continued to play Goofy and Pluto in almost every cartoon until 1961 for Pluto and 1967 for Goofy. Not only was Pinto the voice of such classic characters as Pluto and Goofy, he also provided the voice for Practical Pig in Disney's hit, The Three Little Pigs.
I built my house of stones. I built my house of bricks. I have no chance to sing and dance, 'cause work and play don't mix.
He also appeared as the grasshopper in Grasshopper and the Ant.
Listen, the good book says, the Lord provides. There's food on every tree. I see no reason to worry and work. No, sir, not me. Oh, the world owes us a living. Oh, the world owes us a living. You should soil your Sunday pants like those other foolish ants. Come on, let's play and sing and dance.
This is for the Grasshopper and the Ants, during which, and Pinto wrote this, the theme song for Grasshopper and the Ant, and did the voice for the Grasshopper. But you can see the energy, you know, they're laughing, it's natural light, the light bulb is turned off. This time there's a guy at a typewriter, you know, or maybe it's a dictation machine, must be a typewriter, you know, trying to capture the energy, capture all the ideas that are thrown out so nothing gets lost. This is what it was actually like, and of course Pinto has drawn an arrow pointing to himself.
When Disney's first animated film came up, Pinto was diligently working in the sound department. His brilliant comedic voice work won him not one, but two parts in Snow White, Grumpy and Sleepy.
You're sleepy.
Hard to get.
I'm warning you. If the queen finds her here, she'll swoop down and wreak her vengeance on us.
But she doesn't know where I am.
She don't, huh? She knows everything. She's full of black magic. She can even make herself invisible. Might be in this room right now.
Of all the grief that a body of men ever endured, I believed it was the time we recorded the Dorf Soup Slurping Symphony sequence from Snow White. But due to overfootage, the final editing, it was cut out of the picture entirely. We had in seven-part harmony a catchy waltz melody, which instead of being played on orchestral instruments, was slurped, sloshed, gurgled, splashed, dripped, and gulped. The natural dipping of the spoons into the chinaware soup plates accented the rhythm. For days, seven of us sat around a table with napkins tucked in our necks, and in front of each soup plate was a spoon and his individual music sheet. Accordingly, each represented one of the dwarfs. I did Grumpy's part, who slurped bass, while Jimmy McDonald sipped the afterbeats for Doc. One of the first things to be decided was what kind of liquid might be used as a substitute for soup, as none of us seemed to have an appetite for soup, particularly at 8 o'clock in the morning. Ordinary water was out because it would be too thin for good slurping. For a while, beer looked to be the general choice, but was finally voted down because of its foaminess, which would impair the tonal qualities of both slurping and dripping. Buttermilk was finally agreed upon, but because Jimmy McDonald didn't like buttermilk, he chose cold chocolate milk instead. I had a certain way by which I could slurp up my long bass tones without swallowing the liquid. Not that I disliked buttermilk, but I foresaw a tough recording was going to run into too many long hours a day for several days. Emily Post would never sanction the manner in which I did it. I simply allowed the soup to run back down the end of the spoon and into the bowl. Not a pretty thing to do, I'll admit, but after all, this was done in the name of art. And too, the after drippings helped the recording greatly. The others, all except Jimmy, got into my method, and the long siege of rehearsal takes and retakes commenced. Never has the human ear heard such grand and melodious soup slurping. It was not only beautiful, but I say it was enchanting, awe-inspiring, and unsloppy. In some of the bowls, we added bits of crackers, the particles adding zest and staccato to stagger the monotony on some of the sustained slurps.
Before Snow White could come out, however, Pinto was fired from the Disney studios.
So that was 1936, and this was about the time when Pinto got fired from Disney. According to his book, Pinto went through a nervous breakdown at the time. There are intimations elsewhere that his nervous breakdown took the form of alcoholism. We may never get to the bottom of that, but he was fired.
Pinto's departure from Disney meant that the increasingly popular Goofy went voiceless for several years. A select few shorts featured a sound-alike voice for Goofy provided by impersonator Danny Webb, who also did Elmer Fudd's voice in Looney Tunes. Pluto was replaced by Lee Miller, Verna Felton's husband, who you can learn more about here. Pinto was offered a job with Fletcher Studios, where he worked on their 1939 film Gulliver's Travels, which was made to compete with Snow White. For this, he voiced the town crier Gabby, who was spun off into his own short-lived series.
Well, what's a rainy day? Never mind that cloud. Behind that cloud, you'll find a golden ray. All's well. Laugh your fears away. See the light ahead, right ahead. There's a moonlit night ahead. Everyone, come on, have fun. Oh.
He also voiced Bluto for the studio's Popeye the Sailor cartoons, replacing Gus Wicky.
We don't need no Stoochie.
Come on and dance, Shrimp.
Who, me?
Yes, you.
Oh, I'd love to.
He also began working on radio, providing voices and sound effects, including the sounds of Jack Benny's Maxwell on the Jack Benny program. In 1939, Kolvig began performing for Warner Brothers Animation Studios and MGM, where he voiced a munchkin in the 1939 film The Wizard of Oz. In 1941, Lee Miller, the man performing Pluto, passed away. Also, in 1941, Pinto Kolvig returned to the Disney studios to continue performing Pluto and Goofy. Coincidence? Well, I can't really find anything to confirm my suspicions, but I have a feeling I'm in the right on this one. You remember Pinto's fascination with clowns and love for the circus? Well, listen to this. In 1946, Pinto was cast as Bozo the Clown for a children's storytelling record album and illustrated read-along book set. He became very popular and served as the mascot for Capitol Records.
Hello, hello. I'm your old friend, Bozo the Clown. I'm sure you've heard me on records and enjoyed all the Bozo-approved albums, too. But today I've got a great surprise for you. I'm going to take you on a trip to my circus. Yep, Bozo Circus, where I live and where all my animals are, and the elephant and the sea lion and all the rest of it. While you're watching it, I'm going to tell you all about it. So are you all ready? Okay, let's go.
KTTV in Los Angeles began broadcasting the first show of Bozo Circus in 1949, featuring Pinto as Bozo with his blue and red costume, big red hair, and white face clown makeup on Fridays at 7:30 p.m. He stopped performing Bozo when the rights were bought in 1956. Pinto continued to play Goofy and Pluto until his death on October 3, 1967, at the age of 75. What can I say about the guy? Pinto Kolvig is a pioneer in show business. He was there at the beginning of animation. He was there at the beginning of film, sound, and television. He was always looking for his next opportunity, and he never gave up. And I'm sure we can all appreciate the vast amount of talent he brought to the Disney studios through his work as Pluto, Goofy, and Practical Pig. Oh, and I almost forgot, Grumpy. Thank you for watching this episode of Dizographies. Click the thumbs up button below if you liked it, and if you want to be notified when the next episode comes out, consider subscribing. Comment below with characters you would like to see us cover. Further reading and references are linked in the description. We hope to see you in another Dizography.